stand as we get ready to worship.
You are the
You know, back in the book of Joshua, when the children of Israel were getting ready to cross over into the land, you remember the Lord said, or they were told to take some stones out of the middle of the river, you know, the Jordan River. When it parted, you know, I mean, I say it parted, it walled up. Isn't that crazy? Mm-hmm. Can you imagine? You know, God said this. He said to set your foot. Set your foot. Okay, that means that the water was still there, right? Sometimes we walk into places and we say, God, I don't see your hand. But he has given you a word. He has given you the knowledge and the spirit to know that you're supposed to go. You're supposed to go in. You're supposed to take it. You're supposed to receive whatever. And you say, but God, I don't see it. He says, it's all right. Go ahead. Go ahead. And as they step their foot into the Jordan, it walled up. That's pretty cool. It walled up. The water stopped. And they went, hey, they didn't go through trudging through mud.
That's right.
Said they went through dry ground. Pretty cool. They went through dry ground. But he told them, in the middle, I want you to take 12 stones, one for each of the tribes. And I want you to take them, and when you get to the other side, I want you to place those stones over there. You know why? He wanted them to remember.
Amen.
How often God does something amazing in our life. He does something so good, so awesome. And then something happens to us, and we get into this pitiful, poor me attitude. You know what I'm talking about? Oh, God can't do that. It's too big. God can't do this. It's too big. That's why he said, set those 12 stones there. You remember what I did.
Amen.
People in our lives, we have to set stones. We have to set reminders. That's why the word tells us, think on these things, whatsoever things are good and lovely and praiseworthy. And think on those things. Think on those things, because those things will bring back the Spirit of God working in your life. This morning, I know there are several sick. I know my mom has been battling it. My dad has been battling it. I know Sandy continues to battle. But we were just out there talking yesterday. And you know what? We've seen God work miracles.
That's right.
We've seen it in the past. I said, Sandy, don't read Google. Don't read what, you know, what is that WebMD says. WebMD only has part of the story.
That's right. Amen.
We know the one who wrote the story.
Amen.
And so when you know him, you know that all things are possible. I said, girl, read those things. Read those things that are positive. Read those things that happen along the way to people where they were healed and delivered, and build your faith.
Amen.
We're going to continue as a church praying for one of these days. She said when the flu kind of dies down and everything, because she is being cautious. She's using wisdom. Just because we trust God does not mean we can throw out wisdom, mm-hmm. right? And she said when maybe that goes dies down a little bit, she's going to come and we're going to corporately pray for her together. But for right now, and I know many of you have been, we're going to continue here. But there are several of you. I know Shauna has lost a father-in-law this week, and so many people have gone through different things, but I'm telling you what, God hasn't changed. I'm sorry, you want to say
Amen.
Something?
I want to pray a special prayer for Sandy.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel like God needs us to. I know we've done it before, and although it's not possible every week to do, you know, for everybody, but Sandy has been a part of our church since its inception. This church and Dale is our functions as our head usher and our security head of security at the church and all that kind of stuff. So they're a pretty important part of our church. We all are, but that's a special thing, as you I know you understand. So I'm gonna lift up Sandy, and just pray that God would just do a miracle. Father God, we come in the name of Jesus, and we thank you so much, Lord, that your healing hand is already at work in Sandy's body and in her life, Lord. And we know that her and Dale believe your word when it says that by your stripes she is healed, so we claim that promise for Sandy right now in Jesus' name. We rebuke the devourer. We rebuke the cancer. In the name and by the authority of Jesus Christ, we have been given that authority by your word, so we rebuke that cancer right now and speak healing into her body in the name of Jesus. Healing and wholeness, divine health is Sandy's right now in the name of Jesus. We declare it and we stand upon your word, Father, and we thank you for that. And we give you praise, honor, and glory, and minister your peace to her and to Dale, through this trying time. And we thank you, Lord, that although the storms blow, the wind blows, the waves are rocking the boat, but you're in the boat. You're in their life's boat. So just continue to minister to their needs as they ride this thing out, and we continue to look to you as the author and finisher of not only their faith, but their healing. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
You know, Brian, I think I need to share this. I was talking with Sandy. One thing that we have said, and we said in here, or at least on Wednesday about this, is we don't deny that there's cancer in her body or
right.
in folks that are going through, but we do deny its right to stay there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I was sharing this with her. I remember back when I was in high school and getting ready to go to college, and you had to take a chest X-ray, you know, to get to enter a college. And mine came back, and they said, "You have a cold." I was like, "I don't have a cold." They said, "Yes, you do." "Okay, I do." You know, and doctors are always right, right? And so I came back in a couple weeks to take another X-ray, and they said, "You still have a cold." And I said, "I don't have a cold." So anyway, they ended up sending me to Barnes Hospital and to do a biopsy, because I think at that point they probably thought they were dealing with some cancer in my lungs. And they when they sent me up there and they did a biopsy, they found a disease called sarcoidosis and told me, you know, "We're not going to do anything right now, but, you know, you need to watch your activity. You don't need to run. You don't have..." Well, now you can think that isn't a big deal. Back then it was. I was going to a college where you ran. You got your aerobics points and all this and that. And I thought, you know what? I'm not going to receive this. I know what's in my body, but the deal is this. I know that God has a work for me to do, and I need to be healed. You know, so, Dad, you remember, and some of you that were back at Grace Methodist, I kept coming forward to be prayed for, you know? And I remember going back to the doctor, and guess what? My lungs still had it in it. And guess what I did? I just sat down and gave up. No, I said, "No, God, I believe in your word. I'm believing your word." And you know what? I went back till I got a clear X-ray. And I know that God heals. You see, I want to tell you, that is some stones that I've set up in my life.
Amen.
Because when things come and they look too hard, I look back and I say, "God brought me through that. God healed me." I look back through losing a daughter and I say, "Hey, that was awful. That was horrible. But God is bringing me through." You hear what I'm saying? People set up not so that we memorialize and just dwell on that, but because we want to remember what God has done. How many of you in here, God has done something in your life?
Amen.
Remember it. Remember it. Remember that God is good. He wants to work in our lives much more than we even ask him to. He wants to. Prayer team, would you make your way up here? And I'm just going to ask this morning, whatever is going on in your life, whatever that you want somebody to pray with you about, they're here, ready to pray.
Tender whisper of love in the dead.
there's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're a living hope. Your presence, Lord. Thank you for your presence. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free. My shame is under your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. So glory, God, is what I'm It's mean in this church, but it's also mean in this place right here. Right here. How many want the presence of the Lord to walk with them? I'm raising my hand. Let's just sing that with our hand lifted, saying, Jesus, I want your presence in this place.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and
Father, it's impossible to count the many ways that you care for us and show and demonstrate your love for us. You're so regular and consistent with demonstrating your love for us, Lord, that we just take it for granted that you're gonna protect us. And so I pray, Lord, that you will help us to walk with an attitude of gratitude in these days, Lord. Even though we have struggles in our life, we know you're with us. You said you'll never leave us or forsake us. And I pray that you'll help us to access the power that we already have inside of us through our relationship with you, through the presence of Jesus Christ, your Son, in our hearts, through your Holy Spirit, Lord. And though we are not left alone, we have you, Father, that said you'll be with us always. And we thank you, Father. When we have you with us always, we got all the benefits of what that means. Help us to recount those benefits, to remember those benefits. Like Pam was talking about, remember what you have done in our lives. Help us to remember that those past events let us know that we can have faith in you in the present. You haven't changed. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I pray that you will help us to walk in the assurance of knowing that whatever we encounter in life, we can do all things through Christ who gives us strength. We have the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world but also sits on the throne. And we thank you, Father. We look forward to your soon coming return. Lord, we get a feeling it's a lot closer than we might have imagined. So help us to be ready and help us to prepare those around us to be ready and to take as many people with us as we possibly can. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Hey, Brian, while we're being seated, I want to introduce John.
Yes.
John is a new member of our band, and we are excited to have John with us. And also, we have a an announcement about a new baby being born. And I know there's some folks in here real excited about that. You notice Brian is missing this morning. I don't know why, but he just thinks he needs to be with that baby. But they, Ryan and Bree, had their little baby Adeline on Wednesday. And so that makes Don and Sandra a grandma and grandpa.
Uh-oh. Woo-hoo.
And Karen, I don't know if Karen's here this morning, but Karen Moore is Brianna's mom. And then that makes Don and Barb and Joyce and Jerry great-grandparents. So congratulations Woo! To everybody. It's awesome. And one announcement, we didn't do an announcements this week, but we do have one since Wednesday, and that is on March 10th at 6:30, we're inviting all the ladies to a fiesta. I think you saw the looping announcements that we had it announced in there, but we have a fiesta where we're going to ask all the ladies just to bring a some kind of Mexican dish. And we're going to have an awesome time. We are going to be done at 8 o'clock. We will make sure it's just, right on time. And I think Sherry, right? Sherry Farmer is going to be giving us a devotion. So it's going to be a good time. If you've never been, that's all right. We've done a lot of different things, but this is a newbie. So, and Donnie?
This Saturday, the men.
Oh.
Yes.
I didn't
have that
down. I
was getting ready to announce that, yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah.
Well, okay. This coming Saturday, the 4th, it's a chili supper sponsored by the men. It's a fundraiser, but we're going to have some fun, too. It's going to be a chili supper and an auction. Supper starts at 5, auction at 6. I got that right, don't I? Okay. So we want to invite all of you. There'll be some neat stuff to auction off, and the men raise money and help scholarship some guys to go to men's conference in the summer, and if there's other causes that come along, we try our best to contribute to that as well. So it's all used for the glory of God, and so we invite you to do that. We always have a good time. We do a lot of laughing. Laughter is good for the soul, so it's good like medicine. All right, we're going to call the ushers down at this time to receive tithes and offerings. Thank you for your faithful giving. I want to thank you for that. God is blessing us here at Grace Christian Fellowship, and everything we do a lot of things here. We really do, reaching out and a lot of ministry goes on. There's a lot of materials from children to youth to adults, and a lot of outreach that goes on, and we do it because of your faithful giving there, and that's the fruit of your giving, but we do it because we love Jesus. We love Jesus with all of our heart, and we want them to know that, and we're going to show them practical ways by being obedient to his word, by giving to him.
Father God, right now, Lord, we just come to you, Lord, and the Lord right now, our country's in a bind, Lord, where the world's in a bind, Lord, where we're needing your touch, Lord, we're needing your healing touch, Lord. All the sickness, Lord, that's going around, The diseases, of the Lord, we just lay them before you right now, Lord.
That's right.
Just heal our lands, Lord, and just so we can go on worshiping you, Lord.
Yes.
Just be with us and guide us. Everything that we do, Lord, just
yes.
May we glorify you. Mm-hmm. Lord, right now, this offering that we're about to take, Lord, just use it to further your kingdom, Lord. Mm-hmm. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. All right, all the children, come on down. We'll meet with you for a couple minutes down here. Yes. Hey, I want all the little ones to come. Oh, sorry, sugar. Didn't see you there. All the real little ones, come get real close to me.
Right in a circle, right by the...
Yeah, come on over here. Little ones. What is that?
For the offering.
Okay. Well, you need to...
Here, let me take it back.
Yeah, she'll put it in the offering bucket. All right. All right. All right, make a circle around me, and you get close, all the little ones, because sometimes I can't see you very good, because you've got all these tall people in front of you. Now I can see you really good. All right. Come on in, sugar. Yeah, here we go. All right. So praise the Lord. Well, listen, you know, there's a lot of people around us that have been sick. Have any of you been sick, cold, and stomach stuff and all that kind of stuff. There's a lot of that going around. And you know, we just need to know that we can pray for people and God hears us and he can heal and touch people. You know, Jesus did that, didn't he?
I guess he
did. Yeah, well, we can ask Jesus to help us to be healed. And when we... God can heal that too. But we walk around and we see people, our family, our friends that are sick. We can pray because Jesus heals us. Jesus knows how to heal us. He's got that power in him. Isn't that awesome? And you can pray for people too. Did you know that? I've had my grandsons pray for me and others be healed, and God does that through them. So you don't have to be an adult to pray for people to heal them, okay? So if someone's sick, you know, and if the adults, if your mom and dad or others don't remember, say, hey, let's pray for him or let's pray for her. Well, let's pray for you or pray for me. If you're the one sick, pray for me, all right? All right, everybody bow your heads and close your eyes. Lord, I thank you for all these children. What a blessing they are, Lord, and I just pray that you will bless them. Help them to know, Father, they've got the power of Jesus in them to pray for healing for others. And I speak healing if they're sick. I also claim your call upon their life. I call forth those pastors, preachers, teachers, evangelists, missionaries, Christian moms and dads, Christian government workers and businessmen and women. And I just thank you for each and every one of them, Father. Just bless them. Fill them with your Holy Spirit. Help them to know, Lord, that they have the power of Jesus in them, no matter if they've got if they're in a little child body or a grown-up body, Father. Your power is the same. Just bless them. And we thank and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, you can go downstairs now to be with the folks down there. You can take that to your mommy, okay? Oh, somebody lost a very valuable plastic ring. I'm sure they'll come looking for it. Praise the Lord. Praise God. I am going to be preaching on a topic today. What does it mean to be in Christ? I'm going to be preaching about Christ-likeness. This message that I'm going to share with you, I did share with the Crossroads back in October, a version of it. And so some of this may sound familiar to some of you that attend Crossroads. But it's something that's going to kick off some things for me in my mind and my heart and my what I want to talk about today and probably the coming weeks. So it's really it's an exciting topic for me because I believe out of all the things the Bible tells us, this is the goal. This is the key of what the heart of everything that God asks us to do in the Word is to be like Jesus. And I know that sounds like a pretty big task and kind of probably overwhelming to a lot of us. But it doesn't have to be overwhelming. God has called us to do the impossible. Not me. Oh, yes, he has. He's called you and I to do the impossible. Is it impossible to live like Jesus? If you try it on your own, it is. But when you have Jesus inside you, you know, there you go. You've got the power that it takes. Pam and I saw a very interesting movie last night. And this is a movie that I'm going to highly recommend to everybody to see. It is a Christian movie, and it's called I'm Not Ashamed. It's a story of, what's her name? not Cassie Bernal, the Columbine shooting. Rachel Scott, thank you. I have a good memory, it's just real short. But Rachel Scott, and she was one of the tragic ones that got shot at the Columbine High School shooting back in 1999. Anyway, this story, she was a Christian, and the story chronicles her last year or less than a year of her life. She was high school, and it showed some normal struggles. She was wanting to do the right thing, be the right person, normal struggles of teenagers, and then she came to the point in her life where she just, gave it all over to Jesus, you know, surrendered fully. And of course, she was one of the ones. She ministered to people. And as I watched that movie, I was, of course, you know, my message came to my mind about that's what it means to be Christ-like. She fully surrendered to Jesus, and that's when Christ-likeness begins to rise to the top of our lives. And I like what Donnie says, you know, less of me and more of Jesus. And that's what Rachel Scott did, you know, less of me and more of Jesus in her life. So, and so as we were watching this movie, you know, I'm watching this girl who gets fully sold out to the Lord, fully sold out. And it's hard anytime, but when you're a teenager in high school where there's a lot of junk going on in a secular high school, that gets pretty tough. And of course, she ended up giving her life as that gun was being pointed at her. So I do highly recommend that. And I think she is a prime example of what it means to have Christ-likeness as your number one goal in life, number one purpose. That is our number one purpose in life. So if you'll turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, we're gonna look at Christ-likeness. Now, there's a lot of scriptures I'm going to refer to today. And again, excuse me, so I'm wrestling with a little bit of a cold today. But I am being healed in the name of Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into His likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. We are being transformed into His likeness with ever-increasing glory. In other words, we are growing spiritually to become more like Jesus. And that's what that is all about. May God add His reading, blessing the reading of His Word today. Now, Christ-likeness, we need to define what Christ-likeness is. It's to be like Jesus. Now, that's a given. Everybody gets that. But it conjures up all kinds of thoughts in our minds. All right? What does being like Jesus mean to you? Well, some may have this image of a monk up in the mountains and cut off from civilization and you know, doing Gregorian chants and whatever else you may imagine, poring over a Hebrew-only version of the Bible hour after hour after hour, you know, and fasting long periods of time, all this kind of stuff. Anyway, it's like, you know, no joy, no leisure, no fun, you know, that kind of thing. Is that what Christ-likeness is all about? I don't believe that's accurate scripturally, but, you know, if you want to do that, you go right ahead. But I'm not going to stop you. But I don't think that's accurate what the Bible talks about when it talks about being transformed into His image. And then there's others that think about being Christ-like. They think of those long lists. Lists of do's and lists of don'ts. You know, things we shouldn't and things we should do if we really want to be holy. Things like don't watch any TV, listen to only gospel hymn music, don't eat fatty foods. That hits about all of us. Don't laugh or make jokes because being a Christian is serious business. You know? So all these thoughts come into our mind. Then there's people who simply want to please Jesus Christ. Those who want to know Him in a personal way and try their best to imitate Him, trying extremely hard not to make any mistakes. You don't want to make any mistakes. These folks have the right heart, but have a tendency to become legalistic and be so hard on themselves that they have no joy and become highly critical and judgmental of others who aren't living right. So, right heart, wrong motive. Wrong focus. So we've got these categories, and there may be some more. I'm just throwing these out as possible categories of people, how we sometimes think about Christ-likeness. And all three of those are inaccurate, to say it nicely. So what is Christ-likeness? What does the Bible say about it? We are commanded in the Scripture to be like Jesus. That is, we just read some. There's others that we're going to look at that, that is, accurate then, would be like Jesus. But isn't this, if you sit back and think about it, isn't this asking a bit much? You know, after all, I'm only human. Okay. So but we're still called to be like Jesus. So now let me give you a definition here. And if you have your sheet that you picked up out there with the binder holes in it, the note sheet, you'll see this on there, Christ-likeness. So we're all on the same page. It's not mere imitation of Christ. In other words, we don't just mimic the actions of Jesus, but we live out our position in Jesus. We're not mere imitation of Christ, but living out our position in Christ. Now, we just got done with the presidential election and have a new president of the United States. I'm not going to get into all the stuff there is about that. Anyway, pray for your country. Pray for us. I don't care who's president of the United States. But I'm just here to say that, a lot of people have a high regard for president of the United States, no matter who it is, over the years, over the history of the United States of America, and they really admire the president of the United States and maybe even want to be president of the United States. You can't ever pay me enough money to be president of the United States. But, a lot of people aspire to that and want to be like the president. So they study the president, his actions, his thoughts, his mannerisms, and all those kind of things. And they, but does that make them the president of the United States because they mimic the actions? No, you've got to be put in the position of being president of the United States. And what we're talking about here is more important than any earthly position, including the president of the United States. We're placed into a position of with Christ, and we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. And that makes, I don't care what earthly thrones you're talking about, this is higher and better and more powerful or more blessed than any earthly stuff. And because the earthly stuff is going to fade away anyway. So as we look at this, it's not mere imitation of Christ, but living out our position in Christ. Now, to actually become president, you'd have to be put in a position. So too Christians. Too many of us are running around trying to imitate Jesus Christ. Now, I got to say, it's better than imitating a lot of other people I can think of. There's a lot of people have idols out there. I'm talking about music idols, TV, movies, whatever, famous people, and they go around, they dress like them, they put their hair like them, and all these kind of things, and they got their idols. But there's people that try to imitate Jesus too, and obviously that is the best one if you're gonna do any acting. act like Jesus. So, but this condition, trying to imitate Jesus, is causing many of us to experience a lot of failure and a lot of discouragement because we fall short. It results in becoming increasingly frustrated, paranoid, and disillusioned, and wore out, okay? And when I think of abundant life, I don't think about being disillusioned and wore out. That's not abundant life. Merely attempting to imitate Christ is a poor example of what kingdom living is all about because we limit God's activity in and through us by our own human limitations and willpower. We limit Jesus if we're just trying to mimic him when we've got more power inside of us. Jesus Christ is our best example of how to live abundantly. However, he must become more than a hero to us. He is a hero, but he's more than that. He's God. God of the universe. And if we have Jesus, we've got him inside. We got to understand that. Merely attempting to imitate Christ is a poor example of that. And he must become. He must become the very means, the energy, the source of life by which we live day by day. In fact, when we do baptism, that signifies we die to ourselves and we live for Jesus. The old Brian died when I gave my life to Jesus, and baptism symbolizes that, if you want to read Romans 6:4, that we are dead to Jesus, dead to ourselves, alive to Jesus, raised to new life. So the less of Brian the people see, the better off, right, Donnie? That's his prayer. He prays a lot of time. The less they see of Brian, the more they will see of Jesus, if I'm doing it right. If I'm doing it right. So, in order to be proper, to properly understand, we must get two basic concepts here, deep down in our spirits. Who Jesus really is, and who we really are in him. Okay, who Jesus is, and who we are with Jesus. Okay, so who is Jesus Christ? Who is he? Who is Jesus? If our life's goal is to be like Jesus, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that we must know who we're trying to be like. Now, if we've been born again, then we've got to get busy finding out who is in here. The gospel writers give us a very complete and balanced view of who he is. Now, you may or may not have, if you do a lot of Bible study and maybe get online and do some in-depth study, you may have heard these before. I would guess that most of us probably have heard of it, except for some of the Crossroads people that heard this last fall. So there are four in the Gospels. We got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Those are the Gospels. And we call them the autobiography of Jesus, basically. It kind of sums up the life of Jesus. But these Gospels look at Jesus from four different points of view. I like to equate, and I've shared this with the Foundations class, it's kind of like four blind men trying to describe an elephant. Right? You got one that's feeling the tail, and say, well, it's like a long, leathery, little leathery thing. And another one feeling his leg, no, it feels like a tree. Another one feels the side, and no, it's like a leather wall. And then the other's, you know, feeling the trunk, and say, well, it feels like a big old snake to me. But they're all describing the same thing. So these four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are looking at Jesus and experience Jesus from slightly different points of view. They have some similarities. If you've done much study of the Gospels, you'll notice there's some similarities in there. Some of the same stories come up, some of the same miracles, but then there's a lot of differences as well. And that's good. That's a good thing. It gives us a more complete picture. So these images of Jesus, these descriptions of Jesus, as you study the whole book, that's what I'm referring to here. In Matthew, he is likened to a lion. And Matthew is likened to a lion who is the Messiah King who rules and reigns. Rules and reigns. In Mark, he's likened to an ox. An ox. And he's referred to in symbolic form a Jehovah's servant. He's a servant who came to humbly serve. Remember, as he washed the disciples' feet, he referred to himself I didn't come to be served, but to serve, and to give my life as a ransom for many. And then in Luke's emphasis on Jesus, it's as a man. Well, wait a minute. I thought he was the Son of God. But he also he's being referred to here as the Son of Man as well. Why is that important? It's because he came in the flesh to tell us and to communicate to us, he understands our struggle, but shows us that our flesh is no longer an excuse, because he showed us how to live victoriously while living in a fleshly body. He knows we have struggles. He was tempted in every way, like as we are, yet was without sin. He is tempted in every way like as we are. Now, that's a lot of temptation. Every way. That's a lot of temptation, people. We were talking in Foundation's class. We were going over the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness in Matthew 4 today. There were four basic components of that temptation there that he had, a face-to-face confrontation with the devil. When was the last time that happened to you? Face-to-face confrontation with the devil. But these are represented four basic things. But there was many, many ways that Jesus was tempted, yet he didn't sin. So here we are. A man, Jesus Christ, came and was born from a woman, his creation, and then was raised by his creation, and then lived among his creation in a body like his creation had. And so he knows. He knows what you struggle with. You think Jesus ever wrestled with his thought life? Sure he did. He's tempted in every way. Thoughts, you know, feelings that was not right, temptations, whatever. I mean, whatever, you know. But he conquered them in Jesus' name. He fought that battle and he won every time. It shows us that he not only understands, but we can have victory too, because we live in the body. And then, that's Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Now in John, Jesus is likened to an eagle. We in America love eagles. Eagle, the Son of God. The Son of God, the eagle. Who is God in the flesh? He is truly, Jesus is truly divine, all-powerful, all-loving, all-conquering, above all gods in a human body. The emphasis is upon the God part of Jesus Christ in the book of John. So you got the lion, the ox, the man, the eagle, the king, the servant, a man, and God Almighty, all contained in one person, Jesus Christ. But while knowing this is absolutely critical in our pursuit of Christ-likeness, it's not enough. Head knowledge, not enough. It's good. We need to know that. Once again, we got to remind ourselves, what is Christ-likeness? Christ-likeness is not mere imitation of Christ, but living out our position in Christ. And what does that mean? Well, there's a whole bunch of scriptures that have to do with this. Who we are in Christ. Colossians 1:27. How are we to see and understand ourselves as we are in Christ? There's a whole gamut of things. We're just going to look at a few. There are so many scriptures. There's not time to go through them all. We're going to hit a couple high points. Colossians 1:27. Christ in you, the hope of glory. The very presence of God within us always. But what exactly does this mean? So we'll go on to Colossians chapter 2, verses 2 through 3, 6 through 7, 9 and 10. We're just going to hit some of those highlights in Colossians 2. Attaining, what is Jesus? Attaining to all the riches of the full assurance of understanding. Riches of the full assurance of understanding. To the knowledge of the mystery of God, both of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. As you therefore have received Christ, Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. No, I'm kind of emphasizing some words here. Full assurance, treasures, walk in him, abounding in it with thanksgiving. And then verses 9 and 10, for in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. In other words, in the body of Jesus Christ was all of God. And you are complete in him who is head over all principality and power. Now, I could preach a 6-month series on those verses, and we wouldn't get finished in 6 months. Those are powerful. Those are heavy, and those are deep. And I encourage you to study those more after our time is over this morning, because this gets to the real heart of who's in us. Who is in us? Basically, what this is saying, once we begin to understand the riches and the power of this mystery, that God Himself really does live in us, that we have godly wisdom and knowledge at our disposal. Last week we talked about hearing the voice of God and learning to hear that voice. And now we see we have God's wisdom and knowledge at our disposal. We can know the will of God. We can know Jesus Christ and know how to handle certain situations. I'm not saying we have it all down pat every time. I'm just saying if we're walking with God, we got that potential inside of us to know how to deal with situations as they rise as we walk in Him. Once we know this, once we got this knowledge, then we must walk in Him, rooted and built up, which means to live confidently, knowing what we've got. It's important to be a confident Christian. I don't mean prideful. I don't mean arrogant. I don't mean obnoxious, but confident in who we are. Who has God made you? What has He done for you? Who is He in you? The hope of glory. You can walk in that confidence. You don't have to fear. You don't have to fear anything, really. Fear is the opposite of faith, by the way. You thought doubt was, right? No. Fear is the opposite of faith in some ways, because we're not, we feel like something else is more powerful than God or Jesus inside of us. And so we go to the fear thing. So we must walk in Him. Faith without really living it out is simply dead, it says in James. It's dead faith. I love this story, and we talked about it last fall. But this is I love this interview that one time several years ago, Michael Jordan, you know, the Bulls superstar. We all know Michael Jordan, right? Know of him? Well, in one game, he scored 69 points. Okay. Being in the pros is tough. Doing that in the pros, that's like, you know, major. One of his teammates was interviewed on television not long after that, and the teammate was asked about one of his most memorable experiences, and he said, "Well, that's easy." He said, "I'll never forget that the night Michael and I scored 70 points." Reminds me, it's the same thing about the story about the flea and the elephant. The flea was on the back of the elephant. They came to this swinging bridge in the jungle going across a river. And the elephant was kind of wondering what he should do. And of course, the flea is, you know, whispering in his ear, "Go ahead, let's go. So the elephant walked across the swinging bridge, and it was straining for all it's worth, and it's swinging back and forth. But they did finally make it to the other side. And the flea said to the elephant, "We sure shook that bridge, didn't we?" We serve a big God. We serve a big God. I don't care whether it's scoring points in a basketball game or whether you're, you know, walking across a bridge. You know, we're kind of like that guy scored 1 point, and we're kind of like the flea when it comes to God. God, the power's inside of us. The power's beyond us. It's not our power, but it's the power that we have access to. So Jesus has all the power and authority over every principality and power, and He can help us to do it all. You know, we quote it all the time. You hear me? I'm sorry if you get bored with it. You know, I can do all things through Christ, you know. I guess I have to depend on that a lot in my own life, so I quote it a lot. But I can do all things through Christ who gives us strength. Heard a great illustration of that, by the way, which we won't get into right now because of time. But I just know that if we can learn to access that power and to live in that power and to walk in it every day, we don't just wait until, you know, we need a miracle of some kind, you know. And the power's there too, but I'm just saying it's an everyday thing, walking in that power and that confidence. Power and confidence. But now comes the best part. Listen to this. Now comes the best part. Because the fullness of God, all that He has promised is inside of us, we too are full and complete. No more empty life. No more feeling disjointed. We are full and complete in Christ. Here the word fullness means full number, full complement, full measure, that which has been completed. And here's the end of this definition here, and I love this part more than anything. The word describes a ship with a full cargo and crew, and a town with no empty houses. Now, a full crew, full cargo, no empty houses. So the needs are met. The needs are met. Everything's complete. You know, I don't know about you, but I like to complete tasks when things are done and got everything we need and all that kind of stuff. And I know life doesn't happen that way too often, but that's a good feeling. That's a good feeling. I'm a little bit OCD when it comes to completing stuff sometimes. I want to make sure things are done. And I like that complete, but we are full and complete in Him. It doesn't mean all the work's done. It just means we are full and complete in Him. What a great feeling. What a feeling of purpose. And so the Lord tells us that we are full and complete, but then Satan comes along and circumstances happen. The winds begin to blow. The waves get high. People say and do stupid things. Yeah, I said stupid from the pulpit. It happens. We do stupid things too. But, and all these things begin to happen around us. They're, in the end, all caused by Satan, if you go back far enough, to keep us from discovering and living our abundant life in Jesus. He doesn't want us to know. He didn't want you to know how powerful you are. So He'll keep you sidetracked. He'll try to make you feel intimidated, fearful, afraid of what someone's going to think about you, as if that matters. Please people. I don't want anybody mad at me. I've discovered no matter what I do, people are going to be mad at me. Sometimes, yeah, not all people. That sounds pretty pessimistic. I didn't mean it that way. I just mean sometimes there's some, what's the saying? You can please some people some of the time, but you can't please all the people all the time or something like that. Okay, some smart guy said that. Anyway, I'm sure to tell you that if you get caught up in that web, that's hard to get out of. You got to get Jesus to deliver you from that one. People pleasing, that's a tough one. It's not that we walk around thinking we're better than anybody else. We just know that some people just have a hard time being satisfied with anything, you know, and we're included in that sometimes too. But I'm just saying that Satan throws out all kinds of stuff to try to hold us back. So if you're here today and you're feeling empty and you're wondering why there's only... You're wondering why you're feeling empty and you're not experiencing abundant life. There's really only three basic biblical answers if you're feeling this way. First is, you don't have Christ in you at all to start with. That's a starting point. If you don't have Jesus, you don't have access to any of this. You know, you're left to do life on your own. And that doesn't work out too well. We all know that. But if you're here today and you've never received Christ as your personal Savior, I pray and I exhort you in the name of Jesus, please don't walk out these doors without Jesus. That's the most important, critical decision that anybody can ever make. So that's reason number one if you're not experiencing emptiness in your life. Secondly, if you're experiencing emptiness in your life, you've accepted Christ, but you have allowed known sin to rule you. You can be born again, but allow sin in your life and let that bind you up and keep you cut off. The wages of sin is death. Now, there's two ways to look at that. Wages of sin is death, and that can mean a temporary death, or it can mean a permanent spiritual death from God, if you don't have Jesus in your life. Another one says, sin builds a wall up between us and God. It builds a wall up. And we'll experience that emptiness if we're allowing known sin. I'm wording this very carefully now. We all make mistakes on occasion, but allowing known sin will keep you weak and powerless. Allowing known sin in your life will keep you weak and powerless. And so you can't wonder why you're not living the abundant life. It's because we've allowed sin. And yes, we all wrestle with our limitations in our flesh. We know that, but we have the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, it says in Romans 7. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thirdly, if you receive Christ, you're still feeling this emptiness. You may have allowed you're trying to live purely, you're trying to do it right, but simply don't understand the awesome riches and the power that you already have in Jesus. And I find that to be pretty common, that most of us do not understand the riches and the power and authority that we have. And who are you in Jesus? Who are you? Who is in you? That's why we talked about who Jesus is, and man, we just barely scratched that surface. That's why we talk about it every week, because there's so much more to learn. You failed. If you know Jesus as your Savior, but you're walking and you still feel some emptiness going on, you fail to realize you're already complete in Him. It's part of it, that you're already complete in Him as you walk in what you already know. Your confidence lacks because you've allowed your limitations to dictate your thinking more than the awesome power and provision of Christ, who is in you the hope of glory. The hope of glory. Sometimes the greatest treasures, are in the simple things. There's a story about this man who loves to do garage sales. Carolyn Jordan would be a good friend with this guy. And he'd go to different garage sales and find different things. And this guy was into rocks. He loved rocks. And this one, garage sale went to, had the clothes and the used tools and all that kind of stuff. And then over a little small table has some rocks. Well, this one rock looked pretty interesting. That's probably why it was up on the table. But I said, okay, how much for this rock? It was a pretty good size one. He says, $5. So he paid $5. I can't understand paying $5 for a rock unless you wear it on your finger. But so he took the rock, went home, and took it home. He says, the more he looked at that rock, the more he said, something's different about this rock. It's more than just a rock. So he said, on a whim, I maybe get laughed out of the store, but I'm going to take this to a jeweler and let him look at this. And he took this jeweler and said, I found this rock at a garage sale, and it looks like it might be something that I'm not used to. What can you tell me what it is? And so the jeweler took it and took his little monocle thing and looked at it real close and everything. And he kept saying, "Oh my gosh, oh my God!" And the guy said, "What? Oh, I can't believe this! Oh my!" He had found the world's largest opal, worth several million dollars. I think it's worth $5. What do you think? Worth $5. Get a $5 million thing, not knowing what he had. Not knowing what he had. Do you know what you've got? Do you know what you've got inside you? You don't have the world's largest opal inside you. That's nothing. That's nothing compared to what you got with Jesus. If you got Jesus inside you, you've got power, you've got authority, you've got wealth, you've got everything you need for life and for godliness and all that, and you don't have to be afraid of life anymore. You've got confidence in Jesus because he's the one that leads the way. He's the one that gives you what you need. Please stand with me. I'm well aware that all of us in here are imperfect. That's why we need to meet every week, right? To learn how to walk with Jesus better, learn how to be better Christians. So we're not preaching this sermon to perfect people because I'm not one of them and I know you're not either. But what we are looking at is the perfect one. The perfect one. And with Jesus inside of us, the riches of glory in Christ Jesus, we are full, we are complete, and you have what it takes. But you may be here today and you haven't surrendered to Jesus. You know about Jesus, you've got the head knowledge, but don't have the heart change. We need to have the heart change to be surrendered to Jesus. Now, there's two kinds of surrender. There's the first time of surrender, where you say, Jesus, I need you. As my Lord and Savior, I repent of my sins. That's when you become a Christian. The other kind of surrender is a full surrender. And let me tell you, that takes everyday commitment. Where every day you get up and say, Lord, I surrender to you again. Because if not, our flesh can come and take over again. Sin can come in. We can get distracted. And when the list goes on. So we need a full surrender to Jesus every single day. With every head bowed, every eye closed, I want to ask you this question. If you're here today, and I know I ask this every week, but I don't want to stand before God someday and say, you should have asked that day because there was someone there that didn't know me. So I don't want to be caught without asking this question. Do you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? What do you mean by that, Brian? I mean, have you ever, at some specific point in time, that you can recall that you have asked forgiveness of your sins, you realize you needed a Savior, that you were lost without him, and you asked Jesus to forgive you, and you asked him to come into your life, to take over your life, made a commitment to him, and was born again. If you can't remember a specific point in time when that happened, then I would dare say you're probably not saved. And if you're here today and you find yourself in that position, today can be the day. Today is the day of salvation for you. Put your hand up. We want to pray with you. Don't let this moment go by. If you don't know Jesus Christ, your personal Savior, don't let this moment go by. God has given you another opportunity right now to receive Christ. Is there anybody that does not know Jesus as their personal Savior? Put your hand up. Thank you, Jesus. And we'll pray with you.
Praise you.
I'll give you a moment. This is serious.
Praise you, Lord.
Not a time for games or to think about what you're going to do after the service is over. This is very serious. This is eternity that we're looking at here. All right. The rest of you, for the rest of us, do you have a full surrender to Jesus? Remember, fully surrendered to him. Say, God, I want to give it all to you. I realize that my life hasn't stacked up to what the Bible says, and I've been trying to do it on my own. And I now realize I have the full hope of glory inside of me, the presence of Jesus inside of me to help me to live that out. And I want to do a better job, a more faithful job of living for you, Jesus, by your power, your grace, and your mercy, and your love. If you're here this morning, you want to make a recommitment to Christ, a recommitment, a resurrender, maybe a more full surrender, put your hand up. Put your hand up. I see that hand. See that hand. That hand. That hand. That hand. We're going to pray a prayer, and I'd like to invite us all to pray this together, to join with those who have put their hands up. Lord Jesus,
Lord
Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That you have given me everything I need.
You've given me everything.
For life and godliness.
Life and godliness.
And Lord, right here and now.
Lord, right here and
now. I re-surrender my life to you.
I
more fully surrender my life to you.
Fully surrender.
That you are Lord of my life.
That you are Lord of my life.
I want you to know.
That I know
that you are in control of my life.
Help
me to take my hands off. Be obedient to your word and to surrender to your spirit every single day. Thank you, Lord, for giving us everything we need to live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing. Praise God.
As we're singing, Wanda and Wayne, make your way down.
Yes.
This is their last Sunday with us. They'll be moving across the country. So you can just come on down and we'll just sing.
And Daniel? Oh, he went home sick. He said he wasn't feeling good. Okay. Pray for him too. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Before we sing Go Change the World, we're going to send this couple off with our blessing and with tears in our eyes. They're going up to Washington, right? The state of Washington. Okay. getting as far away from Washington, D.C. as possible, probably. But, no, I'm joking. But they're going up there. They've got relatives up there, and there's reasons they're going. And Daniel was here earlier, their son, and he's been sick for the last
2 weeks.
Yeah, 2 weeks. And he told me outside before the service that he wasn't feeling well, and I guess he had to leave and go home for that. But anyway, we want to pray God's blessing upon them. Wayne and Wanda Lisenby, they've been a part of our church for, gosh, 3 years, and came to our church and just became such a big part of us. And they helped down in the kitchen, helped cook, and Wayne was our custodian for a while, and just whatever is needed. And they just are very willing helpers. And Wanda also leads a Bible study over here at the nursing home, and has. So anyway, still looking for somebody to take your place over there? Oh, cool. Awesome. Okay. So anyway, we just want God to just use them in the state of Washington and the trip along the way. And we're going to pray for their safety and also for their healing. So stretch your hands this way. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for Wayne and Wanda and for how much they mean to us, Father. And Father, it just goes without, we don't have the words to express how much we love them. And Father, you love them so much more. And so just bless them, help them to know, Father, that you are with them. You will never leave them or forsake them. And Father, help them to walk in that confidence, live that confidence of knowing who they are in you. And that, Father, that you will use them, Lord, in Washington in this new chapter of their life. So just bless them. Keep them safe along the way. Pray that everything goes smoothly. And we do pray for their healing in the name of Jesus for Wayne and Wanda and Daniel. And we just plead the blood of Jesus over them. We speak divine health into their bodies. And we'll be very careful to give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to ask Wayne and Wanda if you would to join us out by the front door. So if you want to greet them on the way out, then you can give them a hug.
We have a
church out there. It's called Grace Christian Fellowship.
Really? They got a new church they're going to check out. It's called Grace Christian Fellowship. How strange is that? Yeah.
That's original.
Yeah, I remember. I do remember. So we're going to check that one out.
That's awesome. We also have a baptism here. 5:30-ish?
Six.
Is that what time is?
Whatever.
Okay, it's 6. Here with Crossroads, and so come join with us. And our life group, meet up here real quickly afterwards, as soon as we get done singing here, just meet up here. If you're not in a life group yet, come on, join us. Come up here and talk with us. We'll tell you where we'll be tonight.
Yeah.
Let's go change the world. Yeah.